Hi everyone, welcome back to my YouTube videos on the topic of discrete-time Markov chain. This video is going to be the last one, maybe not the last one I'm going to record about this topic, but at least the last one in terms of logical structure. That's the one you should see last. So to explain a little bit what I'm going to do, if you remember what we saw in the previous videos, we saw a lot of different concepts. So for instance, we talked about communication classes, irreducibility, period, stationary distribution, limiting probabilities, fraction of time spent in a state. We talked also about recurrence, transience, positive recurrence, null recurrence. And it might feel overwhelming, and it might feel that all those pieces that we saw seems to be a little bit independent. So what I'm going to do in this video, the main objective of this video is to remind you all those concepts and to put them all together. So right now you know all the pieces of the puzzle, and the goal is going to show you how we can indeed put all those pieces together. And for that, I'm going to show you mostly a big diagram that holds in only one page. This diagram is inspired from my textbook called Stochastic Modeling and published with Springer. And you can find this diagram on, I think it's page 123, it's chapter 7, one of the 17 chapters of the book. And chapter 7 is the one about discrete-time Markov chain. So to get started, let's remove this book so that we have space to put our equations. And to make things a little bit more fun, I'm going to add this kind of nice background. So I don't add this background only because it looks pretty, but also because it's related to the topic we are studying. In fact, this picture is generated by a very short and very simple C program I wrote that simulates a stochastic process called bootstrap percolation. That's a type of stochastic process that was introduced in the 70s, and it turns out that this is a discrete-time Markov chain. So that shows you that you can indeed generate very pretty pictures using discrete-time Markov chain. So now let's display some equations and let's try to understand how we can study a Markov chain. So first step, once you have your Markov chain, so be careful, the most natural process you can think of is not always a Markov chain. We saw examples like that. This happens, for instance, if you have a process such that the future depends on the previous two or three time steps. For instance, xn plus 1 depends on xn and xn minus 1, in which case, if you keep track of two consecutive time steps in a row, then you can define a Markov chain by increasing your state space. So if you depend on the previous two time steps, you increase your state space and your state space becomes S squared. If you have dependency on the previous three time steps, your state space can become S cube and you still get a Markov chain. So first step, be very careful of the way you define your process. You need to make sure that this is indeed a Markov chain to be able to apply everything I'm going to talk about. Once you have your Markov chain, step one is always, no matter the question asked, the first step is always to write the transition probabilities. So I remind you that the transition probabilities are those probabilities PXY that describe the probability that we go from state X to state Y in one time step. And you see that in my equation here, the left hand side does not depend on N, but the right hand side does. This means that we assume that the process is time homogeneous, meaning that the evolution rules are not going to change over time. So once you have your transition probabilities, that's pretty messy and that's very difficult to work with that. You want to use them to do two possible things. Maybe one of them is enough, or maybe you need to do both of them. So you want to use them to either write the transition matrix or to draw the directed graph representation of the process. And I quickly remind you that the transition matrix is just the matrix of the transition probabilities. So that's a square matrix where the number of rows and the number of columns are both equal to the number of states. While the directed graph representation is just a directed graph such that the set of vertices is the set of states, and you are going to have an arrow going from state X to state Y if you can go from state X to state Y in one time step with positive probability. So whether you want to use one or the other, the matrix representation or the directed graph representation strongly depends on the question you want to answer. Sometimes you might need only one of them. Sometimes you might need both. Typically, you need the matrix for everything that is, I would say, quantitative when you want to compute something. But if you want to study more qualitative aspects of your process, it's better to use the directed graph representation. So, what can you do with the transition matrix? So again, this depends on the question asked or the question you want to study. If your goal is to find the multi-step transition probabilities, then you want to use the transition matrix, and we prove that a consequence of Chapman-Kolmogorov's equation is that those multi-step transition probabilities could be written as the coefficient of the transition matrix raised at the power n, if you are looking for the n-step transition probabilities. So that gives you one path, the one going completely left. Step one, transition probability. Step two, transition matrix. Step three, multi-step transition probabilities. Now, what you can do also from the transition matrix is compute explicitly the stationary distribution. However, at this stage, you don't have enough information about qualitative properties of the process to know if there is indeed a stationary distribution or if there is only one stationary distribution or there might be multiple stationary distribution. But still, you can find all the stationary distribution by solving the system pi p equals pi, okay? And I remind you that consequence of linear algebra, the system pi p equals pi, the set of solutions of this system should be a vector space. It turns out that because the matrix P is stochastic, P minus identity does not define a bijection. So that means that the set of solutions has to be a vector space with dimension at least one. If the dimension is exactly one, this means that you have at most one stationary distribution. And if you can find a particular solution such that the sum of the coordinates is finite, this means that you have indeed existence of at least one stationary distribution. So then now let's move to the right part of the graph. First I need to talk a little bit about particular cases. So so to compute the stationary distribution, so of course, computing, solving pi p equals pi is much easier than computing the multi-step transition probabilities and taking the limit. But still, the system might be sometimes a little bit complicated and a little bit tricky to solve, in which case you might use other techniques. And so it's possible that you can be in those two different cases where your matrix is doubly stochastic, your process is doubly stochastic, which means that P transpose is also a stochastic matrix, in which case the uniform distribution is always going to be a stationary distribution. Be careful, that's true if your state space is finite, not if your state space is infinite. Or you might use also time reversibility. Sometimes your process is time reversible, which means that you can find a solution to a set of equation called the detailed balance equation, and in which case you can find a distribution called
time reversible distribution, and we prove that a time reversible distribution is always stationary. So that's how you deal with the quantitative aspect. Now let's look at the qualitative aspect. Using the directed graph representation, you can more easily find the communication classes of the Markov chain. So I remind you that two states communicate if you can go from one to the other both ways in a finite number of steps with positive probability. But you can also easily find the period of a state. And for that, you are going to look at all the possible paths going from, let's say, x to x. Look at the length of all those paths and take the GCD of all the lengths, and that's going to give you your period. So at this point, you can extract a lot of information from your Markov chain using the transition matrix and the directed graph representation. So now we want to do better. We want to understand things about the convergence theory. So this part of the diagram is really the basics about Markov chain. Now everything I'm going to display below, it's about the convergence theory, and we are interested in mostly two the existent uniqueness and value of mostly two limits. The first one is the fraction of time spent in a state, and the second one is called limiting probabilities. So first, once you have your communication classes, you can see if the process is irreducible or not. I remind you that irreducibility means that there is only one communication class. And if indeed you have irreducibility, then this means that there is at most one stationary distribution. You cannot have multiple stationary distribution. So hopefully your process is irreducible, in which case you have two options. Either the state space is finite, that's the easy case. And in this case, you get from irreducibility and finiteness of the state space, you immediately get a positive recurrence of the process. But if the state space is infinite, everything can happen. Your process can be positive recurrent, it can be null recurrent, or it can be transient. And there is no way to tell just based on the fact that the process is irreducible. So here there are several options. In case your process is positive recurrent, the way you can prove that it's positive recurrent, that's by solving, coming back to the system pi p equals pi, you solve this system, and if you find that the set of solution is a linear one-dimensional vector space such that each solution has the sum of its coordinates finite, then that means that there exists a stationary distribution, and from that you can deduce that the process is positive recurrent. So you are back, if you look at this dotted arrow going to the right, you are back to like the finite case. Even if the state space is not finite, the process is going to have all the good properties that a finite Markov chain has. So this is what I'm talking about now. It's only for irreducible Markov chain. Now, what happens if your process is not irreducible? Well, you have to do this analysis class, communication class by communication class. And I remind you that the conclusion is the same if your the communication class you are looking at is closed. So if the communication class is closed, again, it's going to be positive recurrent if it's finite. It's going to be, we don't know, if your communication class is infinite, in which case you again want to look at the stationary distribution, but you know immediately that if your communication class is open, meaning that you can jump from a state from your communication class to a state outside your communication class, in this case, you know that your communication class is going to be transient. So everything I'm talking about, saying that your communication class can be null recurrent or positive recurrent or transient, means that is a consequence of the fact that those three notions, recurrence, transience, positive recurrence, null recurrence, are class properties. So then let's go back on the left of the diagram, and now let's assume that your process is not positive recurrent, and you want to know if the process is null recurrent or transient. So the distinction between those two things will be that if your process is null recurrent, the time it's going to take to return to your initial state is going to be almost surely finite. It's going to be infinite in expected value, but it's going to be almost surely finite, which means that your return to your initial position infinitely often, and also that you visit all the states infinitely often, while transient means that states are only visited a finite number of times. So the only way you can decide whether your process is null recurrent or transient in this infinite case is by returning to your multi-step transition probabilities and looking at the infinite sum of PNXX. If this infinite sum is infinite, then that tells you that your process is recurrent. In case you already excluded the possibility of positive recurrence by solving pi p equals pi, then you can conclude that your process is null recurrent. That's the case, for instance, of the one and two dimensional random walks. But if your infinite sum is finite, in this case, you can conclude that the process is transient. So we use this characterization of recurrence and transience to study symmetric random walk and infinite lattices. And using this characterization, we were able to prove that the one and two dimensional random walks are null recurrent, while the three dimensional random walk or random walk in higher dimensions is transient. Okay, so then from that, if you are in the case where the process is null recurrent or transient, the convergence theory is extremely easy. You have all at once all these branches of the graph. You know that there is no stationary distribution. I'm going to show you this again after in the diagram on the right hand side, but remember that the existence of a stationary distribution is equivalent to positive recurrence. So if your system is, if your process is null recurrent or transient, then you have no stationary distribution. You can also deduce that the fraction of time spent in a state is going to go to zero. And you can also deduce that the limiting probabilities converge, and they all converge to zero. So in the case of transience, that makes sense. You only visit each state a finite number of times, so it makes sense that the probability of finding your process in this state in the long run, or the fraction of time spent in this state should go to zero. But it's a little bit more tricky to see it, but that's one of the theorems we proved. It turns out that it's also the case when the process is null recurrent. Even if you return to a state infinitely often, if the time it takes to return to your state is infinite in average, then the fraction of time spent in this state or the limiting probabilities are all going to converge to zero. So now let's go to the other side of the diagram, which is the most common type, where you have either a finite irreducible Markov chain or an infinite irreducible Markov chain, but that is positive recurrent. So in this case, you might get positive recurrence just because the process is finite, in which case you still want to be able to compute the stationary distribution. And so for free, you have existence and uniqueness of the stationary distribution. And again, here I remind you, with this arrow going up and this other arrow going down, that in fact, positive recurrence is equivalent to the existence and uniqueness of a stationary distribution in the case of irreducible Markov chain. If At the opposite, you are in the case of infinite state space, and the only way you were able to prove positive recurrence was by already solving your system pi p equals pi, then you already have your stationary distribution. So in case you don't have it yet, you can solve after observing that the process is irreducible and finite, and so positive recurrent, and so there is a unique stationary distribution. The next natural step is to solve the system pi p equals pi to find this stationary distribution. And here, the theory of Markov chain, the convergence theory, tells you that because of irreducibility and positive recurrence, the set of solution of your system pi p equals pi should be a one-dimensional vector space such that all the solutions have the sum of their coordinates equal finite, such that you can take a particular solution, which is not zero, divide by the sum of the coordinates of this solution, and from what we call a stationary measure, you are going to get your unique stationary distribution. So then, starting from this point, the convergence theory is simple for when you look at the fraction of time spent in a state. So now you again have convergence of the fraction of time spent in a state, but now the limit is not zero like on the left-hand side of the diagram where we were in the case of null recurrence and transience, but at the opposite, you are in the case where you converge to a positive limit, and this limit is given by pi y. So the coefficients of the stationary distribution are going to give you the values of those coefficients, are going to tell you the fraction of time spent in each state. Okay, so that's why you want your stationary distribution. And from that, you can deduce one more thing. You can conclude also that the mean recurrence time at state y, EYTY, so that's the expected amount of time you need to go from state y to state y, is going to be equal to 1 divided by pi y. So remember that by definition, positive recurrence means that those mean recurrence times are finite, but be very careful. If you have to solve a problem about mean recurrence time, if the question is about finding the mean recurrence time of a state, I would say never try to find it directly. It's never going to work. The best way to find the mean recurrence time is to first argue that your random, stochastic process, that your Markov chain is positive recurrent. If it's transient or null recurrent, you can deduce that your mean recurrence time is equal to infinity. But if you are in the case of positive recurrence, then first you want to prove that the process is positive recurrent, and then you want to solve pi p equals pi, get your unique stationary distribution, and from this one, from the stationary distribution, you can deduce the mean recurrence time. This is much easier to first find the unique stationary distribution and then the mean recurrence time instead of the other way around. So now we are almost done with our picture. There is just one last thing that we need to do. If you look at the bottom left corner of my little tree here, we can tell that when the process is null recurrent or transient, there is a convergence of the limiting probabilities to zero. Now, what can we say about those limiting probabilities in the case of positive recurrence? And this is a part that is a little bit tricky. It turns out that irreducibility and positive recurrence are enough to get the fraction of time spent in a state and the mean recurrence times, but to get also convergence of those limiting probabilities, you need one more ingredient, which is aperiodicity. So now you need to come back at the, your directed graph representation to find the period of your Markov chain. And if the period is equal to 1 and your process is irreducible, remember that the period is a class property. So if your process is irreducible all the states have the same period. If the period is one, then your process is aperiodic. And if you have those three ingredients, irreducibility, positive recurrence, and aperiodicity, then you can conclude also that the limiting probabilities P and XY are going to converge to the stationary distribution, to the unique stationary distribution. Now, be careful that aperiodicity is a necessary condition to have this conclusion because indeed we saw a counterexample in which the period is not equal to one and we don't have convergence of those limiting probabilities. The simplest example we saw was the symmetric random walk on the square, and for this process we saw that the unique stationary distribution is the uniform random variable on the set of vertices, but we saw also that the limiting probabilities do not converge, and the lim inf is equal to zero and the lim sup is equal to 1/2. So those limiting probabilities in fact oscillate. Okay, so this explains why it's possible that the fraction of time spent in a state converges to a value, but the limiting probabilities do not. This happens if those multi-step transition probabilities oscillate, in which case we have some Cesaro average that converges and that corresponds to the fraction of time spent in a state, but the limiting probabilities themselves, they do not exist. The multi-step transition probabilities do not converge. So I'm done with my picture. I hope this was helpful. I know that everything we saw before in the previous videos, that was a lot of information. And now you have all those information put all together in the same diagram. So now we have all the pieces of the puzzle put together. You can stare at this diagram for a while to really understand all those logical connections. But if you really understand this, then you have really all the recipe to study a Markov chain, a discrete-time Markov chain.